benvenuti all'Istituto Italiano di Cultura. To welcome again a very dear friend, I would say, because it's the second time we have the pleasure of hosting here a talk of Dr. Marius Zerafa, who is visiting Aquinas scholar at St. Michael's College at the moment. He is lecturing in Toronto and around Toronto, and he has graciously accepted to lecture also at the Istituto. Last year, for those of you who haven't been, we had a very interesting lecture by Dr. Zerafa about how he retrieved Caravaggio from Malta. Malta is his home city, his own land, his own country. He has, however, studied a lot also in Italy. And in particular, he has studied history of art. And his first love, I think, with Italian art was the topic of tonight. Beato Angelico, Fra Angelico, a Dominican. Like Padre Zerafa. Padre Zerafa is also a Dominican. And he's at the moment here at the Dominican Institute, which, by the way, is close to us. It's on the south side of Huron Street. We have here Father François from the Dominican Institute, Julie from the Dominican Institute, and we are really happy. I want to thank everyone of the Dominican Institute for this cooperation. Father Dias is coming later on, who is the responsible for the Institute here in Toronto. They do a wonderful work, a wonderful job with young people, with scholars, and they are a great part of this Torontonian community. So the lecture will be, if I had to read all about what Dr. Zerafa did, I would go on for a long time, but I think suffice it to say that he is still working a lot, writing a lot, and he has been for a long time also responsible for the museums of Malta, art museums of Malta.
Basta.
Okay, so the talk is on Beato Angelico. I just want to tell you that it is in the so-called Snapshots of Tuscany, a series of events we have organized during this month of June, which is the Italian Heritage Month, together with the Bata Shoe Museum. So, for those of you who are interested in the other things we have organized in this project, please take a leaflet when you go out. It's on display. So, thank you again for this pleasure, and the floor to you.
Well, it's good to see that so many of those who survived last year's lectures are here again. Okay. I want to thank the director of the Italian Institute for being so kind to invite me again. It's said that Oscar Wilde was invited everywhere once. Okay. Being invited here twice means that I'm not as wild as he was, okay? One thing that Wilde used to say was that art is unnecessary, not in the sense that art is not necessary, his own life he tried to make a work of art, but in the sense that he thought that we should judge art on its own merits. Actually, I'm going to talk about somebody who used art as ancilla theologiae, as handmaiden for religion, because he was a Dominican friar of the Reformed Dominicans, and obviously he used his art to teach. Argan, the great historian, speaks of Angelico as Sanctus et Doctus. He was a saint, he's been beatified, he's the patron of art and artists, but he was also a Doctus in the sense that as Arthur Kahn explains, he was the angelic painter, the Angelico, following on the angelic doctor, in the sense that he put the ideas of St. Thomas Aquinas, the angelic doctor, into colors, into lines, that people could get the Christian message. It's no longer a question of ars gratia artis, art for the sake of art, but he used art to preach, as was his mission as a Dominican. The Dominican motto, as you know, is contemplata alis tradere, to pass on to others the fruit of meditation, his thought. So that's the way that he expressed himself. Obviously, last year, as the director was telling you, I was here to lecture about Caravaggio. Completely different personality. Caravaggio was a criminal, a very rich criminal record. He was arrested at least seven times, committed a murder. Very different from our artist today, who joined the order, we are told, for the salvation of his soul. He joined at Fiesole. His real name was Guido. Then in the order he was called Giovanni da Fiesole. So he lived in this very reformed community, as we'll say, explain later on. And he was always painting religious art. I don't think there's only one instance that he painted a mythological subject, and I suspect that it's a fake, it's not a genuine work of his. Anyhow, so very different from Caravaggio in all senses, even in his style. Remember, those of you who were here, who survived last year, I was explaining how Caravaggio used the luce di cantina, painted in a black room with a strong ray of light, to pick out the highlights. In the case of Fra Angelico, there's no darkness, no shadows, it's all light. There's the claritas that St. Thomas speaks of as the essence of art. Right? Nobody, Ruskin says, nobody could use colors the way that Fra Angelico did. It's difficult to follow his works in a sort of chronological order, apart from the fact that probably I mixed the slides up because I'm no good at organizing the slides, but we'll take them as we come along, as we go along. But you'll see, I have got to make clear two things, that he painted, he was living in a difficult period. Those of you who've been to the exhibition at the museum in the early Renaissance would have seen the style of art that was current in Italy in the 300, in 1300. There had been the revolution by Giotto to turn art from Byzantine into representative, from symbolic to three-dimensional. Vasari says he turned art from Greek to Latin. So there was this great revolt that was so fundamental that for 100 years nobody could quite understand him. Those of you who've been to the exhibition would have seen a couple of works by Giotto, and then minor artists who tried to imitate Giotto without really understanding him. Right, his son Giottino, the Giotteschi, most of them unknown, until we come to the 400, to the Renaissance proper, when there's a burst of creativity in Florence, and that is where we have Fra Angelico. A great artist, a great person, a great religious. Okay, it's difficult to place him because we have so many different sort of approaches to Angelico. Those who read Vasari, he wrote the life of Fra Angelico, and he speaks of that he was Santissimo, rather naive. When he was invited by the Pope, he said, I'll have to ask permission of the prior. He gave his money to the poor. He always stated that those who work with Christ must live like Christ, and so on. And Vasari describes all his works that he wouldn't retouch his paintings because he believed that that was the will of God. He would never paint a crucifix without tears going down his cheeks and so on. Obviously, this is the sort of pious version that was very common. And unfortunately, we tend to forget that apart from being a holy man, which he definitely was, he was a great artist. It's not that he painted great pictures because he mixed his colors with holy water. He had a strong tradition. He was one of the greatest artists of the Quattrocento. Newton, the historian, says that there's one man who understood the modern trend of Masaccio, that was Fra Angelico. So I think before we start talking about discussing his works, I think we've got to describe first of all the situation in Florence at the time. It was a Florentine, essentially a Florentine, a great draftsman, a great technically superb in his fresco paintings and his tempera paintings. And we've got to remember that he was born around 1400. If you go to his tomb at the Minerva, you'll find the date 1385, but that's due to an incorrect reading of the documents. He was born around 1400, which makes him a contemporary with Masaccio, with Donatello, a great burst of activity. Florence was a special city, probably the best representation we have of Florence is the David of Michelangelo, the young man who fought against a giant. So this tiny city that could stand on its own against the rest of Italy, right? Florence was beautifully organized. It had the Medici that created so much work. The Medici defined architecture as biography in stone. Before he died, Lorenzo da Medici said, "I'm sorry I didn't build more," because he was always creating more and more works of art. It was a city that was beautifully organized, the guilds, le arti, every artist belonged to a guild. If you go to Florence, one of the finest buildings is Or San Michele, here at the Palazzo Vecchio, where you get where the arts were established, where each guild had its own patron saint, Saint George by Donatello, the Guild of the Armorers, Saint John by Ghiberti, the patron saint of the linen workers. So it was organized in such a way that the artists worked together. They had a very strong system of apprenticeship. An artist couldn't just go unshaved and unwashed and call himself an artist. He had to follow 4 years apprenticeship and then produce his masterpiece, it was called, and then set up his bottega, which was a very important fact because it not only protected the artist, looked after widows if the artist got to died and so on, but it also created a certain standard in works of art, and it also produced a sort of a family likeness, a continuity between artists. You have Filippo Lippi teaching Botticelli, Botticelli teaching Filippino Lippi, and so on. So there's a continuity, and there's a family tradition that we see in Florentine artists. So that Florence was economically stable because of the florin. The florin was worth its weight in gold. It was accepted all over Europe. So the Medici had contacts in Flanders. And we have even a cross-fertilization in art. We have the work of Van der Goes from Flanders arriving in Florence in 1450. We have important people like the Arnolfini having his portrait painted by Van Eyck in Flanders. So Florence wasn't just a tiny city, it was a very, very important city that, as I said, it was the right place for all these artists. Why they were born all at the same time is something that we can't explain. but I don't think it, the Renaissance was such a great event in human history. I think it's a quite a unique event and something that we can't explain, that all of a sudden we have such great architects, great sculptors, great painters being born practically in the same year, practically at the same time. So that is Florence at the time of Fra Angelico. Florence, that's the situation, the civil situation in Florence. Well, as regards the church, the position wasn't all that pleasant. There had been the Black Plague in 1300. A third of the population had been carried away. After that, people sort of flooded the monasteries and so on, so there was lax discipline. And in 1400, a number of religious orders split up into various groups and so on. With the Dominicans were lucky because a number of very holy people appeared practically at the same time, and they reformed the order. Fra Angelico belonged to the reformed branch of the order. Living with him in San Marco, he had people like Sant'Antonino, St. Lawrence del Prafratta, Cardinal de Dominici. It's not very often that in a priory you have four or five saints living with you at the same time. Okay. Culturally, obviously, there was the Neoplatonic philosophy, which there was the fall of Constantinople that brought so many manuscripts, so much other knowledge to Florence. So it was vibrating with knowledge, with philosophy, with activity, and with art. Okay. And when we see the work of Fra Angelico, you'll understand what was happening. One problem that is rather difficult to explain is this, that at the time there were two traditions, two artistic traditions that we must explain. With Giotto, there was this realistic movement instead of the symbolism of the Byzantine period. Normally, I put it this way, I say that just as St. Francis explained the mystery of the Incarnation by producing the Nativity crib at Gubbio so people could understand, so Giotto transformed the symbolic art of the Byzantine period into something that people could understand, something that represented man. Remember, we're talking about the age of humanism, when man is no longer centered on the other world, but man is centered. It started originally as a literary movement with people like Boccaccio, like Petrarch, and so on. The idea was that man became the center of interest. Know then thyself, presume not God to scan, the proper study of mankind is man. So there's this humanism, which was obviously sometimes was a source of difficulty for the church with the new mythology and so on. So Fra Angelico had to sort of work his way between these two tendencies, right? Artistically, there were two movements. There was this new movement of Giotto, picked up by Masaccio, this dramatic, realistic, expressionistic movement that was sort of the advanced movement. And then was another style that was ritardatario, coming from the past, the old International Gothic, that was appreciated as a decorative feature rather than as a Christian message. So Fra Angelico had to work between these two tendencies. And I'll show you examples to see how he had to produce certain works as decoration for churches, and then certain other works that were meant to give a strong religious message, especially to his fellow Dominicans. Okay, I think we can start with some of the works. Well, this is the chart that I usually use. Here you have the year 1400, and here you have Masaccio and Fra Angelico. So you see, He belongs to that great tradition from Giotto to Masaccio on to Michelangelo, okay? So at one, on one side we have these advanced movements trying to express, in the case of Giotto, in the case of Masaccio, and then we have another movement that is more conservative, living side by side. It's like when you look outside and you see a Rolls Royce and you see a cart and a donkey, all right, moving at the same time. That's the condition that we have in Florence at the time, and that is reflected in the work of Fra Angelico. Okay, yes? Now this is an important painting. This is Giotto, obviously, 1300. For the first time we have a blue sky. For the first time we have a Saint Francis that has had a good meal. That's quite solid, three-dimensional. Berenson speaks of tactile values in the sense that you can practically touch the solidity of the figure. So this is the new style of the Renaissance that will bleed on until eventually we come to Michelangelo, okay? Very different from the traditional art, the Byzantine art, which was more symbolic, which always had, we never had this blue sky, it always had the gold heaven at the back, where the figures were, the size of the figures depended on their importance, and when you had no perspective and no three-dimensional qualities, okay? Yes? This is Giotto, a great dramatist. He painted the life of St. Francis in Assisi and the life of Christ in Padova. And you see the drama, and you see the humanity, Christ there, the confusion with the staves and the stick and so on. So it's an expressionistic movement. Yes, 100 years later, we have Masaccio, who picks up where Giotto has left. He concentrates on perspective, invented by Brunelleschi. This is a famous fresco in the Dominican Church, Santa Maria Novella, where you see the strong play, the surrealism, you see a hole in the wall, you see these solid figures, okay? So it's obviously these mysteries brought down to earth so that people can understand them, yes? This is again a lovely Masaccio, very dramatic. You get the strong anatomy of the crucified Christ, the religious symbolism of the tree coming out of the cross. As you remember last year, we spoke of the plant growing in the tomb with Caravaggio in his entombment, and that very dramatic, almost Germanic expressionism of the Mary Magdalene, that gesture of his parents. So that's the drama of Giotto and Masaccio. It's in the same tradition 100 years after Giotto, yes? Whereas you have also something completely different. If you go to the Uffizi in the third room, you will see this huge epiphany by Gentile di Fabriano, which is extremely decorative. You can hardly see St. Joseph, but you can see all the donkey, the dogs and the horses and so on. It's decorative and it's Gothic. So this is another style which we call international Gothic. That was very popular in the nobility. It wasn't meant to give a message, a Christian message. It was meant to decorate a palace. Some of these panels used to have precious stones stuck on them, because they were not meant to move people, but they were meant to sort of make their owners rather proud with all these decorative features, this lovely Gothic line, the S line, okay, very decorative, but not meant to deliver messages. That's Gentile di Fabriano. In a famous chapel in the Carmine in Florence, probably the most important chapel, it was used to be called the School of Art for centuries, which was decorated by Masaccio, but he died young, and the work was continued by Masolino. So here you've got an Adam and Eve by Masolino, still Gothic. Eve is a Barbie doll, even the snake is decorative. Obviously, it doesn't move you. It's not really a red. Whereas, opposite this fresco, yes, there is another fresco by Masaccio. And here you see the difference. Here, Masaccio deforms the face of Eve, really to show despair, okay? And this is the new message coming down from Giotto with Masaccio. It's a dramatic, all right? Which we find in Fra Angelico when he is painting frescoes for the friars, right? When he is painting decorative tabernacles for the nuns, obviously he sticks to international Gothic. So that's one point that we have to make clear. This is something very realistic. The shadows, the three-dimensional qualities, it's like they cry by Munch, no? There's this sense of despair or anguish that is proper to Masaccio. Yes, this is Fra Angelico, as you say, yes. Now, this is not Fra Angelico, obviously this is just a painting, but I want to show it to you. It's been in Fiesole for hundreds of years, and it's interesting that since soon after he died, he was already called Beato. And when he was beatified, it wasn't because he performed miracles, but because there was an unbroken tradition. Everybody called him Il Beato Angelico, right? His real name, as I said, was Guido. Then in the old, he was called Giovanni da Fiesole, but he's always referred to as Il Beato Angelico, right? Michelangelo himself spoke of him, and he said if he could paint only somebody who had been to heaven to see angels, could paint the angels the way Fra Angelico did. Okay, so that's an unbroken tradition, and in the novitiate in Fiesole, every year, for years and years, they organized the processions. Also, there was an unbroken devotion, and that was the basis on which he was beatified. Yes? Now, this is, obviously, this is Raphael in the Vatican. It's interesting that among the great men, this is the dispute of the sacrament, you know, this lovely room painted by Raphael in the Vatican representing the sum of human knowledge. There's one school of Athens representing all the philosophers and so on. Then there's one with the theologians, and there's the law, and on the other side there's poetry. Now here, he introduces Fra Angelico among the doctors of the church. So there's St. Thomas Aquinas, St. Bonaventure, there's Dante, and it's interesting that the composition of this fresco, it's a great fresco, obviously, Raphael was a great composer. Look at the way he uses the linear perspective and the way that he makes this look like a huge apse, all right, so the room looks double the size that it really is. But it's interesting that this composition of having these saints up here is, in fact, depends on a painting by Fra Angelico, which we will see later on. And it's quite flattering to have Raphael representing Fra Angelico among the doctors and the other churches. That's a detail. It's a lovely portrait. Okay, it's a fresco. Yes. Now, as I said, he was, Fra Angelico wasn't just a holy man who used holy water. He was a good artist even before he joined the order. He was a great technician. He used fresco in a perfect, perfect way. And he was a great draftsman. These are some of his drawings. You know, drawing is the probity of art. And it shows what a good draftsman he was. A study of a cleric, yes. I hope we've got them in order. This is David, the prophet, which he painted for Orvieto, the cathedral, yes. This is it, sorry, can we go back? This is a lovely, lovely drawing, Christ sending the apostles to preach, yes. And another, so this is to show you that he was really technically superb, okay, yes. Look at this, this is a finished drawing for a deposition that I'll show you later on. So he had all the qualifications that you would associate with a master, a great master of the Renaissance. Yes. Now, his first works Every monastery had this scriptorium, had the friars were engaged in painting illuminated manuscripts. Remember, this was a very important form of art. If you go to the exhibition that we have here, you'll see quite a number of lovely illuminations and so on. We know that his brother, who was a Dominican, worked on illuminated parchments all his life. And we know that the great reformer, Cardinal Giovanni Dominici, insisted with the Dominicans that they should use their spare time studying art and producing manuscripts. And he gives a very interesting explanation why he insisted on this. He said, you've got to make some money so that when the friars preach to the people, they can speak freely. They won't feel that they have to be nice to people, so they'll be free to say whatever they like. So this is a illuminated manuscript. It's the Mass of St. Dominic. And here you've got St. Dominic and the saints and so on. Yes. Look at this lovely illuminated initial. This would be the first letter. So there's the famous patronage of the Madonna on the order of the Dominican order. Yes. This is another thing, but I'd like to explain this. This is in another Dominican church in Florence, in Santa Maria Novella. It was in the Reformed branch of the order. It was a very important church. It had that fresco by Masaccio, which I showed you. It had works by Ghirlandaio, The Life of the Virgin. It had a lovely facade by Alberti, and a cloister decorated by Paolo Uccello, who was crazy about linear perspective. It also had a chapel, the Cappella degli Spagnoli, where you get an interesting sort of life in Florence in the Quattrocento, by the Emperor, the Pope, and here you've got the Dome of Brunelleschi, not yet built, but already represented here, and the life of the Dominicans, preaching, hearing confessions, arguing, and so on. And then the famous Dominicanes, the hounds, a play on the word Dominicanes, the hounds of the Lord. Okay, so here you've got these black and white dogs representing the Dominicans. But this belonged to the unreformed branch of the order. Where Fra Angelico belonged to the reformed branch, as we see. Yes? Now, I've got a special affection for Florence and for San Marco. I lived there for some time, and I was lucky at the time to have with me La Pira, probably you've heard of him, who was a Dominican tertiary, who had his room at San Marco. He had his meals with us, and now he started his case for his beatification. And he's buried in San Marco. He used to serve my mass every morning at 7. A fantastic person, got very, very fond memories of him. Yes? That's La Pira, definitely a saint. And we used to say mass in this chapel, all decorated by Gian Bologna. And here you've got the uncorrupt body of Saint Antoninus. Saint Antoninus was a great theologian, a great social thinker, B. Jared, historian, refers to him as the medieval socialist. He wrote about health schemes, he wrote about female nurses and hospitals. This was hundreds of years before Florence Nightingale. And he influenced the Medici. He made them sort of make up for their sins by building the monastery of San Marco that we are going to discuss, okay? And his body is underneath the altar there, still, it's not mummified, but it's still in a very good condition. Yes? No, first one. This is probably the first work that we know of Fra Angelico, even before he joined the order. It's a Gothic, you see the pointed arches. Okay, every saint, the Saint Dominic, Saint John, Saint Peter, Martyr, and Saint Thomas, separated, and you see the emphasis is on decoration, decorative features, the linear, the Gothic line, And here at the back is a very interesting episode in the life of a great saint, Saint Peter Martyr. Saint Peter Martyr was the first Dominican saint. He was killed, and with his blood he wrote Credo, I believe. Probably that was what made Caravaggio sign his name in blood in his great deposition bearing that we have in Malta. Okay? So Saint Peter Martyr was canonized a year after he died, and he was sort of the main saint of the Dominican order when all these attempts were made at reform. This is a lovely panel which he did while he was still in Fiesole. Now it's at the Louvre. It's lovely colors. I mean, it's a coronation, and you've got, it's still Gothic, as you can see. There's a lovely Saint Dominic with gold stars on the on his hair cap, on his habit. There's a Saint Thomas, Saint Catherine, and so on. And you get the lovely lapis lazuli blue, right, which was extremely expensive, but which he used. And as I said, Ruskin says nobody can use the colors the way that Frangelo. It's a piece of color, right? This is at the Louvre. It's interesting that I found a drawing by Degas, of all people, copying the figure of Saint Dominic. Yes, I don't know that well. We'll see if it will come. Now, this is the famous chair that was used, the bench that was used at High Mass, and here he painted the saints up here. You remember Christ in a mandorla. Remember, this is what inspired Raphael when he did the dispute of the sacrament. I'll explain why later on. Here you've got the open tombs in strong perspective. Here you get a lot of Franciscans being sent to hell. It was not because they were Franciscans, they were the Fraticelli, a branch of the Franciscan order that carried their reform to extremes, and they were condemned. Here you've got the usual Dante Inferno, which you find in all churches in Italy, in the 200. And here you get a lovely part, La Danza dei Beati, the Dance of the Blessed. Very Gothic, it's very much like an illuminated manuscript. Yes? No, this is not to do it. This should come at the end. This is the, okay, this is another one. This is a lovely panel in Rome, where you've got this Christ in mandorla again, the saints up in the upper, and here you've got the Pentecost. This is a lovely figure. Remember, we're talking about the Quattrocento, so he's very much ahead of his time as regards perspective and as regards solidity of the figures, yes? The lovely Madonna in Chicago, yes? And then, obviously, his favorite subject was always the Annunciation and the Crucifixion. The Annunciation was a special subject in Florence. In Florence, they even counted their days, their dates, from the day of the Annunciation. And in Florence, there's a famous church called l'Annunziata, which is still extremely popular. It had a portico where they had the first art exhibitions in Europe. Works of art and so on, and inside they've got a very important fresco, a very devout fresco, which they claim was painted by angels, which means they don't know the artist, but it was held in great veneration. Usually it's covered as a silver screen, and for most of the year it's covered, and people go there and brides leave their flowers there and so on and so forth. It's a very special fresco that is really the object of great devotion. So the Santissima Annunziata. This church was very rich, it had a lot of silver, and Fra Angelico would be asked to paint the cupboards where all these silver treasures were stored with the life of Christ. Now this is one of his early Annunciations. This is at the Prado, it's on a panel. It's still Gothic, very decorative. Obviously, the columns are decorative. Look at that lovely lapis lazuli. It's interesting that when he had a commission, he would insist on the use of lapis lazuli. He was a theologian, so he always included the reason for the incarnation, that's the expulsion, the original sin, Adam and Eve, and the apple, and so on. And there's this lovely balance, or we make use of the architecture to create this rhythm, not only in the architecture, but also between the angel and the Madonna. Yes, this is at the Prado. This is a lovelier one, which is at Cortona. Again, he creates this cloister, a space in which he can place his figures. Right, that's the new idea of the Renaissance. Again, you've got the expulsion of Adam and Eve. You've got this lovely angel, this rhythm. It's still Gothic, still the words engraved in the gesso, Ave Maria, Ecclesia Domini. Down here you get the life of the Virgin. This is what we call the predella. So the artist was quite free to create a narrative. But this angel is absolutely, it's still Gothic, still international Gothic. The emphasis is on decoration, yes? Look at this detail, yes? It's absolutely lovely, yes? Look at that. And you can see the geometry of it all. Eh? You can see, have this movement going round. Beautiful. And notice his interpretation of sort of the subject. The angel with the words, the Virgin, the lovely modeling of the face and the hands. Yes, and the fire. Another tiny angel, this is at the Louvre, probably a tiny door, full of light, full of color. Yes. This is considered as one of the great masterpieces of the Renaissance. This was the altarpiece for San Marco. Unfortunately, it was damaged when it was restored. But one thing that Fra Angelico is famous for is his sacra conversazione, in the way that he doesn't present the Madonna in a circle, in a mandorla, separated from the people, but he brings her down on earth and makes use of these figures to create a perspective. You can prolong the lines and you can see they are all leading in towards the Madonna, and they are also creating space. This is probably the first time that we have all this interest, this detail here in this Persian carpet. It's worked out mathematically to create, it goes into, right, a hole in the wall. And very cleverly, he makes use of these two saints, Saint Cosma and Saint Damian. We have them all the time in Florence. For a strange reason, the Medici were not doctors, but I think they made use of their name to choose two doctors, two saints who were said to have been doctors, as their patrons. So wherever you see a painting commissioned by the Medici, you have Saint Cosma and Saint Damian, right? And then you have Lorenzo, Saint Lawrence, because it was Lorenzo da Medici. So his famous church is San Lorenzo in Florence, for which Michelangelo designed the facade, which was never carried out. Okay, so here you've got these two saints in the foreground. Obviously, this would become common in later art, but with Fra Angelico, it's something that is quite novel. And you've got Saint Cosma leading us in onto the Madonna. It's a lovely, lovely. This is all. It's a panel. It's tempera, okay? I'll get questions at the end and I'll explain the technique and everything. Yes? Now look at this. This is the way that you work the carpet. This would be the tabernacle, okay? And you've got this carpet worked in perspective to create depth in the painting. Yes? Another sacra conversazione, making use of St. Peter and Martyr, St. Cosme again, okay, leading in towards the Madonna. Yes, this is probably his great contribution, one of his great contributions to art. This is a small panel, it's in the Vatican. It's still rather sort of old-fashioned in the sense that St. Dominic and St. Catherine of Alexandria presented small according to their importance, all right? And it's obviously still Gothic. You get this Gothic line, all right, the music of line here. The painting is flat,
so it belongs rather to the past rather than to the future. Yes. This is a lovely, lovely panel. It's only a small panel. It's important, it's a deposition. It's important because it shows the influence of Flemish art. So Florence wasn't cut off from the rest of Europe. There was a great deal of cross-fertilization. For instance, as I said, in 1450, a huge panel by Van der Goes appeared in Florence, with chapels that are not clean shaven at all. And from then on, you get artists in Florence, like Ghirlandaio, reproducing these realistic features of unshaven shepherds, okay? So this is quite a lovely composition. It's a fine, tiny panel, but I think it's quite brilliant, yes? Again, a lovely, lovely painting. I think we saw this. This is the one at the Louvre. And it's interesting, in the predella here, this would be the pala d'altare, the altarpiece. This part would be the predella. And then the artist felt free to have a comic strip, you know. So here we have the life of St. Dominic, St. Dominic supporting the church with the dream of the Pope, St. Peter and St. Paul presenting the gospel, the miracle of the fire, the Pietà. Here you've got the angels providing bread, and then the death of St. Dominic. So that's quite interesting. And as I said, the colors, this comes from Fiesole. Was sold, and now it's at the Louvre. Yes. This is the drawing by Degas when he was a student. He was fascinated by that figure of St. Dominic, and he made a copy of it. I came across it. It's quite interesting. Yes. Now, this is an old panel which originally was Gothic. It had a gold background, and unfortunately, the new taste, and they commissioned somebody to paint the background to make it more in keeping with the Cinquecento. Yes? And this is the only work which he did for sort of civil authorities. This was a famous La Madonna dei Linnai Vuoli, a tabernacle, a huge tabernacle for the guild of the linen workers. Tabernacle, the frame in marble, was made by Ghiberti, the leading sculptor at the time, the one who did the famous Gates of Paradise in the baptistry. We still have the contract for this Madonna. He said, I would charge you 300 florins, or as much as your conscience would allow you. Right? But he insisted on using lapis lazuli. This closes with St. John and St. Mark and so on. And here you have the preaching of St. Peter. Okay, yes. Here you've got the famous angels, which became so popular in Victorian England, and they were reproduced. This is a very important painting. This was begun by another artist. You can see it's a different style, by Lorenzo Monaco, who was a monk, who was probably the master of Fra Angelico at some time. It's a huge panel. And then Fra Angelico took it, painted the central part. It's a lovely deposition. I've shown you the finished drawing for this figure. Okay, here you have a view of Jerusalem. It's a very modern rendering. It's almost a Cézanne, a cubistic rendering of the city of Jerusalem. Here you've got the landscape, Tuscan landscape, with the trees sort of perpetuating the distance. Here you've got this pyramidal composition, beautifully composed, a lovely, lovely face of Christ. And then here we've got one of the first portraits in the history of art. That is Michelozzo. Michelozzo was the favorite architect of the Medici, he built Palazzo Medici and so on. He was a pupil of he was the architect of the Medici, the pupil of Brunelleschi, and he was building the monastery. And while he was building San Marco, Fra Angelico was decorating San Marco. Okay? So, yes, let's see. Oh yes, these strange hats and so on probably are here because at that time there was the Council of Florence when there were attempts to unite the Western and the Eastern Church. And they came dressed in sort of strange fashions, which are reflected. But this is lovely. And that's a lovely portrait, and it's a lovely face of Christ. Yes? Look at that. Yes? Look at that. There's a certain peace, I think. That's the message. All right? You can give a religious message in lots of ways. All right? You can have Grunwald representing the drama of the crucifixion and so on. In the case of Angelico, it's this peace that emanates from his figures of Christ. Yes. And this is a lovely portrait. Remember, we're talking about 1400. Eh? This would be about 1420. Lovely portrait. And it's in tempera on panel. Right? Michelozzo. Yes. This, you remember, we saw that judgment. And I said on the left-hand side, you have the Danza dei Beati. These are the blessed. Again, it looks very much like an illuminated manuscript. This is still the traditional international Gothic style, yes? This is the Danza dei Beati. This is quite lovely. Yeah? There's a rhythm. It's Dante, no? The more they dance, the more they move, the more they sang, and so on. Beautiful. The rays coming down from paradise, the St. Thomas, with gold stars. And you get these golden, this Gothic decoration, all right? These beautiful lines. It's like an illuminated manuscript. Yes? Now, as I said, he was asked to paint these huge cupboards that contain the silver treasures of Santissima Annunziata, and there he painted episodes from the Gospel, from the Bible. So here, first he has the prophets. He was not only Sanctus, but Doctus. He wanted to give a message. Yes? Look at that. These are cupboards, right? And he painted a lovely Annunciation here with this perspective again, a nativity, presentation, epiphany, okay? Flight into Egypt. And it's interesting, on each of these, this would be about 1 foot in height. On top, there would be the prophecy from the Old Testament. At the bottom, there would be its fulfillment in the New Testament. Okay, so it was didactic. He was trying to teach the faithful. Yes? Look at this. This would be about 1 foot by 1 foot. Ecce concipis et paeus filium et vocabis nominis Emmanuel. Ecce concipis in utero et paeus filium. Okay? You see, a lot of fantasy, butterfly wings, and so on. What is important is this three-dimensional, this linear perspective, creating space that goes through that entrance onto the garden. Yes? This is lovely. I think this is one of my favorites. He's using just primary colors, blue, yellow, and red, and it's a flight into Egypt, but it's so, and it's just a decoration for a couple, yeah? Lovely lighting, yeah. Nativity, yes? And then he produced a number of tabernacles, they were called. These were precious panels, only sort of 2 feet, 3 feet in height, and they were placed on the altar in Santa Maria Novella. So obviously they are Gothic in shape, there's a pointed arch, there's a lovely Annunciation, again this lovely rhythm, and here an Epiphany, probably seen this in Christmas cards, because it's so decorative, okay, it obviously belongs to the Gothic period, yes? Then there's the famous Madonna della Stella. It's good that all these are now in the Museum of San Marco, so you can see them together, yes? And then this is a panel, which is very important in the history of art, because we've got this architecture background. It's the priory of the Monastery of San Marco, and it creates space. This is Zacharias writing the name of St. John before his birth, okay? It's a very important panel in the history of art, yes? Again, this one, which represents the Monastery of San Marco, and it represents Via Cavour in Florence, which used to be the Via Larga, and then a strange thing, probably one of the first appearances of a cabin, yes? Again, this other panel, these are all small panels. It's interesting. Look, this perspective, there's this tool here, then you move in the shoes, and then the platform. And St. Cosma and St. Damien repairing a leg for that sick man, right? And here, again, you get a sense of distance in the other room. I mean, this would become something quite normal in art, but in 1400, it was still very, very experimental, and as you can see, quite successful, where you made use of that curtain, yes? Again, this is quite lovely. It's a panel, it's the Visitation, and there you've got a representation of the Lago di Trasimeno, okay? It's one of the first time in the history of art that we've got a particular place that is painted in the Quattrocento. Yes? A panel with Dominican saints, yes. This is a lovely, lovely panel with Saint Dominic. I think I've got another detail, yes? Look at that. A lovely modeling, in spite of the gold, which obviously comes from the past, from the Gothic past, but the modeling is so perfect and the expression is so, so advanced. Eh? When you consider that this is tempera and that it is sort of early Quattrocento. This is the Perugia water polytech, yes? Now we come to his fresco paintings. I hope later on I'll get some questions about technique, fresco, tempera, and so on. This is probably the loveliest Annunciation ever painted. It faces you as you go in, as you go up the stairs, and there's an inscription underneath, Nessi Deatur Ave. As you pass in front of this image of the Virgin, see that you do not forget to recite an Ave Maria, right? And the whole beauty, I think, is the fresco, the intensity of the gaze there, and the fact that he deforms the figure. I made a copy of this, which I'll show you, and when you copy a painting, you really get to know it. The color of the toes of the Virgin is practically the same as the background. So it's more or less a disembodied spirit. All right, that's one way that an artist can sort of make his painting or his sculpture turn it into a spiritual expression. You remember the four Pietas by Michelangelo? The first one is so perfectly, all the anatomy is so emphasized and so on. And then you come to the last one, the Rondanini Pietà in Milan. Just before he died, he chipped off all the anatomy and so on and left Christ just as almost like a tree trunk because he wanted the emphasis, he didn't want the emphasis to be on the physical beauty of the figure, but rather to express an abstract concept. Okay, so what Michelangelo did in the Rondanini Pietà thing we have here in this Madonna by Fra Angelico. Yes, look at this. It's a lovely, beautiful modeling. Now I'll explain fresco painting later on. I'll show you some sinopia that he did and so on. And with fresco, obviously, you've got to know your stuff. Michelangelo used to say, fresco painting is the only true painting. I used to say, painting in oils is good for women and nuns, all right? Because with fresco painting, you know, you've got to know exactly what you're doing. You've got to decide how much you're going to cover in a day, la giornata, and you've got to paint into it while it is still wet. The parts that you don't manage to do in one day, you have to scrape off and then start. I'll explain this if you are interested. Yes? Now, this is a lovely lunette in San Marco. This is where the ospizio, where they received guests. So he has two Dominicans welcoming Christ as a pilgrim. Okay? So you see the geometry. The vertical and the horizontal, so it creates this very balanced fresco, yes? Another one in the sacristy, it's Peter Martyr, St. Peter Martyr, very popular in the order in the early days, asking for silence. In silencio et sper erit fortitudo vestra. Now I was explaining that in fresco, I think I'd better say a word about fresco. Then what you do in fresco, you chip the brick, and then you put what is called the arriccio, which means rough plaster with sand, okay? Then on that rough surface, you paint a sinopia, which means a rough sketch to see the size and the position. Usually it's done in red, and you say, let's move it to the left, let's make it bigger, let's move it to the right, and so on. Once that sinopia is ready, then you prepare a drawing on a cartoon, cartone, a large piece of paper. So we have this perfect drawing with holes all along the outline. So the assistant would put the paper on the wet plaster, and then with a bag of black powder, you would go over it to transfer the drawing onto the wet plaster. And while it is still wet, you have to paint, and you put a red, and when it's dry, it becomes a pink, which means that you've got to know exactly what you're doing. If you can't finish more than a certain area, you scrape off that plaster and put it on again the next day. We know how many days Michelangelo spent on the Sistine Chapel, the famous Giornate. Now, sometimes artists cheated and they retouched when the plaster was dry. That is called fresco secco. And the result was that in fresco, what happens is you mix your pigment with water and it penetrates the plaster. Sometimes with the plaster, they even put powder of marble to make it even whiter. Michelangelo did it, Angelico did it as well. Okay? So when the pigment goes into the plaster produces a film and the fresco lasts forever. If the artist cheats and retouches it when it's dry, the pigment falls away. All right? Quite often, you go into a church, you see a saint holding something, and the something is in debt, which means that probably he put in a cross or a sword, a secco, and that. Now here you've got an example. For instance, you can see that this one was added later. Okay, so the plaster did not penetrate and the pigment fell off. Okay, I can show you lots of other examples. Yes? Now this is the great Annunciation that we were talking about. This is the cloister by which was painted and was being built in San Marco by Michelozzo. It's interesting, this is typical of Renaissance architecture. Remember, before this, in the Gothic style, churches went up to infinity and man felt lost in the infinity of God. Right? With the Renaissance, the Italians did not approve of this style. They referred to it as Gothic, barbarian, because it did not follow the classical proportions that they were used to. Okay? So with the Renaissance, we have Brunelleschi bringing architecture again to human proportions. So we have the height of the column equal to the distance from one column to the other, equal to the distance of the column to the wall, right? So, and instead of going back, it's not true that the Renaissance is a copy of classical architecture, right? If you read Florentine historians, they always speak of Florence. We are now the second Athens. Florence is Athens again. Art was dead, now art is living again, and so on. And obviously they made use of classic architecture. We know that before building the dome of in Florence, Brunelleschi went to Rome to study the Pantheon. And there's a letter where he says, I learned the technique, how he could put the bricks in a sort of fishbone pattern, and the musicalità, and the proportions of the... But they did not copy the Greeks or the Romans. For instance, when you have a column here, this is a Corinthian column, Normally you should have the architrave, the frieze, and the cornice, right? In Renaissance architecture, you just have the column, you just have the capital, and then the springing of the arch, right? So this is the cloister that was being built in San Marco. Frangelico obviously made use, this is the Hortus Conclusus, the closed garden, symbol of virginity. And here he creates this space in which he can place these two figures. And this rhythm, remember when we speak of architecture, we speak of frozen music, all right, there's this lovely rhythm, an abstract rhythm, is repeated between the angel and the Madonna. And as I said, the Madonna practically melts into the distance. Okay, now another example of fresco a secco. I noticed this obviously when I was copying it. There should be the dove representing the Holy Spirit. It's come off because it was painted a secco. This rod here, which he uses to create this cubic shape and so on, this should be darker than this rod because it's closer to us. But in fact, it's not. Obviously, that was done a secco, and now it's coming off, okay? Yes, that's already it. Yes, yes. This is where the fresco is at San Marco. As you go up the main stairs. That's one of my students who became a Catholic when she saw this Annunciation. That's my copy. It's not as good as the original, and it's not a fresco, but it's the same size, and I think it's a good way of studying a painting by copying it or restoring it. Yes? And this is another great subject for Fra Angelico. As you go into San Marco, you see this lovely crucifixion, one of the finest heads you'll ever see. The Saint Dominic embracing the cross, beautiful anatomy. There's a sense of peace. I think that's the characteristic of Angelico. And it's very, I mean, considering it's Quattrocento, the anatomy is quite, it's quite right to say that he understood Masaccio as much as anybody else. Yes? Look at that. It's a lovely, lovely. So simple, so beautifully constructed, it's geometric in composition, lovely lines, yes. Look at that, look, that's, okay, it's lovely. And notice, I was explaining how you put it plaster for one day, and then you scrape it off and put new plaster, right? That would be a work he did in one day, right? It's lovely, I think it's, for me, it's one of the greatest. As I said, this is painted on plaster, and obviously the color changes, and the pigment penetrates into the pigment and lasts forever. Yes, but it's beautiful. This is an earlier, much earlier crucifixion, which is in Fiesole. Yes. This is a crucifixion which was carried away, and it is now at the Louvre. Imagine, it's a fresco, the whole wall. When you go up to the Louvre, the main staircase of the Louvre, you've got the picture of Sumptuous, and at the back, you've got this huge fresco. Nowadays, when you want to carry a fresco, you detach it, and you stick it onto wood, on a panel. In those days, they carried the whole wall, right? And it's a lovely crucifixion, it's, with St. Dominic, St. John, and the Madonna. Yes? Now, this is a huge fresco. It's in the chapter room in San Marco, where the fathers used to meet to discuss things and so on. It's again, it's the prophets with prophecies about the death of Christ. You've got founders of religious orders, St. Dominic, St. Francis, St. Benedict, and so on. Here you've got again, St. Lawrence, St. Cosmo, St. Damien, St. Mark, St. John, and the three Marys. The blue came off because blue wasn't good for fresco, it wouldn't integrate, so when you see a fresco, the blue usually comes off. And this is a lovely pattern as a St. Dominic, and then famous personalities of the order, including St. Antoninus, and so on. Yes, look at some of the details, it's lovely. St. Dominic, lovely head, beautiful, lovely head of St. Francis, beautifully modeled, I mean this, and Thomas Aquinas and St. Peter. Yes. And then upstairs in the rooms, this is the best part of Angelico. This is not something he was doing for the nuns or for lay people. This, in every room, they weren't even rooms. It was a dormitory. And in every, with partitions, and in every room there was this window, small window, overlooking the courtyard. And then next to the window, he would paint a small fresco with an episode from the Bible, from the Gospel, for the Dominican living there to meditate. This is one of the loveliest. This is cell number 3. It's the Noli Me Tangere. It's Mary Magdalene. She's the risen Christ, and imagines he's the farmer. And it's a lovely, lovely face, and there's this lovely rhythm right in the two figures. He seemed to be practically dancing on the green. Yes? Look at that face. It's lovely, isn't it? I mean, this is Fra Angelico at his best, the great fresco painter. And when you compare him to Giotto, to Masaccio, you can see that he's as good as they are. And as I said, nowadays he's treated not just as a saint who painted with holy water, but as a fully fledged technician, fresco painter, who produced some of the great masterpieces of the Renaissance. Yes? Now, in another room, he's called the Transfiguration. Again, a solid figure, as solid as any Masaccio. Yes? Okay. And the Last Supper. These are the windows of the room. Yes? Nativity. These are frescoes now, eh? The Resurrection, lovely with Saint Dominic meditating. This is quite modern for those days. The Christ, and there's being mocked, somebody raising his hat and the hand and the rod. And you see the fresco, you can do a fresco, is to obtain that luminosity. All right, when they restored the Sistine Chapel, people were shocked. They said, "You've ruined it." Because I remember the Sistine Chapel, which was called gravy brown, all right? When they restored it, now it's blazing light. But that's how it should be. That is why it's painted on white plaster, to get all the claritas, all the light. Yes? This is another lovely Annunciation in one of the rooms of St. Peter and Martyr. And again, he makes use of that groin vault to create this rhythm. Again, the Madonna is a disembodied spirit. Okay, it's not that he couldn't paint a human figure, but he didn't want to emphasize the physical in order to maintain the spiritual message. Yes? Again, a lovely coronation of the Virgin, lovely composition with the saints around. Yes? This is strange. This is a fresco which I found in the Hermitage in Russia. Okay, so it was carried, the wall was carried from Fiesole, St. Dominic and St. Thomas. It's quite a big fresco, and as I said, it used to be in Fiesole, and now it's at the Hermitage. Yes? This is what the monastery looked like. As I said, St. Antoninus tried to convert the Medici because they took usury, which at that time was forbidden. You remember Antony in the Merchant of Venice, who would take a breed of barren metal from his friend. The idea was that if you lent £100, you had the right to £100. Anyhow, so he said, for your sins, you should do something, and he offered to build this monastery. And he said, it's going to be the best in all Italy. These are the rooms. Yes? And here you've got one of the last frescoes. This is called una sacra conversazione as well, all leading up. And it's next to a window, so the light causes, he painted these shadows, it's a sort of trompe-l'oeil, to give an impression that these capitals really exist. It's a lovely fresco, it's quite huge, all right? And as I said, you've got St. Dominic here, Cosmo and Damian, St. Mark, St. Florence, St. Peter and Martyr, St. leading in the Sacra Conversazione. We see that other artists at the time, like Filippo Lippi, tried to imitate the Sacra Conversazione. Yes? Look at this. Yes? And then look at the details. This is the sort of testament of St. Dominic. See that you have charity, preserve humility, keep poverty. And then he says, the curse of God and mine on anyone trying to introduce property into this order. Okay, so obviously you can see he belonged to the Reformed branch of the order, and that is what his message at the time was, yes? Now this is interesting. This is what is called Essinopia. This was painted for Fiesole, was painted outside. So obviously after 100 years, it suffered the rain and so on. So it was removed and taken inside, and they removed the upper layer. That would be about that thick. And you can see it now, you can see the upper layer, and you can see the original Sinopia, which exists underneath it, right? This idea of Sinopia became popular quite recently because in Pisa, during the war, they had a number of frescoes by Benozzo Gozzoli, the pupil of Fra Angelico, and they were, they were damaged, so now you can see the frescoes and the Sinopia. Incidentally, Pisa was important because if you go to the exhibition, there's a panel by Pisano. In Florence in the 400, you have Giovanni Pisano, Nicola Pisano. They all came from Pisa. Why were they so important? They were important because in Pisa, they had Roman sarcophagi. And they studied Roman classical art. One of the sculptors on the pulpit of Pisa presented a nativity copied from a Roman pagan sculpture. That is why in the exhibition you have this panel of this man from Pisa coming to Florence, representing a panel, representing the painter, for the Campanile di Giotto. Okay, one of the things that brought about the Reformation, the Renaissance in Florence. This influence of Pisan sculptors. They did the Porte del Battistero, and then the final one was done by Gibbon. Yes? Now this is the Cloister San Marco. We've got to rush it because I'm told. You see the humanistic proportions. As you move along the cloister, you feel it's a repetition of modules. And wherever you are, you feel that you are the center. In a Gothic cathedral, if you go to Chartres and so on, you feel lost in the infinity of God. In the humanist architecture, wherever you, it's all geometric, and it's all very rational, very geometric. Wherever you move, you feel you are the center. Yes? Yes? This is one of the loveliest buildings in the world. It's the library at San Marco, one of the first public libraries. And it's pure music, this rhythm. It's so simple. And here you've got all these illuminated manuscripts by Fra Angelico. Yes? This is a cloister, which I restored when I was there. Now it's being used as a place for exhibition for modern art. Yes? Now, something completely different. This was his naughty cousin. This was Filippo Lippi. Okay, he was a Carmelite who ran away with a nun and Lucrezia Butti, and he had a son who was an artist as well. But they were working together, and some artists complained that all the work in Florence was being done by these two friars. Okay, so this is a lovely painting of Lucrezia Butti. It's not sacred at all, that's his son. Quite ugly, Filippino Lippi, but you see the interest he takes in perspective to create the interior of a Florentine house, yes? This is where it all started. It was in Prato to paint the life of St. John, and this is the nun who posed for him. There's the beheading of St. John, there's Herod and so on. Notice the pains he takes here to create this depth. All right, these styles are all used to create depth in the picture. That was the main thing for Angelico and for Filippo. Yes? Now this is Angelico in Orvieto. Yes. Unfortunately, while he was working there, one of his assistants fell on the scaffolding and died, so he didn't carry on with the work. Yes. And the work was finished by, the work was done by Luca Signorelli, who then painted himself and Fra Angelico in the Last Judgment and the Apocalypse and so on. Yes. This is Fra Angelico in Rome at the Vatican. He painted three chapels. Unfortunately, two of them were destroyed to build a staircase. This has just been restored as the Pope's chapel, as the life of St. Florence and St. Stephen. Obviously, far more elaborate because he has seen classical architecture, and it presents the last period of his life. Yes? It's lovely, huh? The more elaborate architecture at the back and solid figures. Yes. St. Florence and the Basilica at the back, distributing the treasures of the church, the poor, yes. The martyrdom of St. Clarence and the judgment, yes. Okay, again, you notice how elaborate it becomes because obviously he was living in Rome and could understand Roman architecture, yes. Look at these details, beautiful, huh? Beautifully modern, yes. This is where he's buried, in Santa Maria sopra Minerva, yes. That's his tomb. Do not praise me because I'm another Apelles, but praise me because I gave all I had to the poor. Right? I was born in Etruria, in the Mugello near Florence. Yes. And this is quite a number of followers. The most important is Benozzo Gozzoli, who in fact went back to Gothic painting. So this is a lovely chapel. If you ever go to Florence, see that you go to the Palazzo Medici. There's the chapel of the Medici, and it's like a tapestry. It's not religious at all. A lot of people, members of the Medici family, approaching the Nativity crib, all right? Very decorative, not religious at all. Yes, look at that, but beautiful, huh? And they painted also in Pisa, yes? Look at the angels, yes. So this is, the importance he gives to the details. So you see that this is what I was trying to explain, which is rather difficult, because you get this Gothic past and then the Renaissance present and future, okay? Which Fra Angelico tried to combine, yes? Look at these lovely portraits. Members of the Medici. Now this is another Dominican who was living at San Marco, Fra Bartolomeo, which at the time he was he taught Raphael, and when he died his unfinished works were finished by Raphael. And you see this is a fresco where he puts the saints up here, and you can see how this would lead Raphael to paint the dispute of the sacrament. Alright? Yes. That's Fra Bartolomeo. Yes, that's Fra Bartolomeo, quite a famous painting at the Pitti. There was St. Peter and St. Paul covered over here. Yes, and this is a modern artist, Annigoni, also in San Marco, but it's a lovely fresco. He lived with us at San Marco, St. Antoninus, St. Catherine of Siena, St. Thomas, and Savonarola. Yes, I think that's all regards slides. Now, that's my work. It was removed from the chapel, so now it's in the staircase as it is in the forest. Now, I think I'm told to shut up, but I'd be very willing to take, I think, the most important part of the lecture. I'd love to take some questions. Please. Questions? Now, please. Yes?
Comment? You said that it was difficult to work with tempera.
Yes, tempera meant a panel, wooden panel, covered with gesso, mm-hmm. and then you painted on it with pigment mixed with water or glue or yolk of egg or white of egg or a mixture of every artist had his own. Right? The problem with it was that you couldn't retouch. And it was a very slow process, as you saw in those But what they did, they carved the plaster with halos, they prepared those before. Sometimes they covered the whole thing with gold, the gold background. So it was a very precious work of art, very slow. I mean, the artist couldn't really express himself, but it lasted forever. And some of the main works in this robot are in tempera, right? Oil came in much, much later. It came in from Flanders, a certain artist, Antonello da Messina, is supposed to have brought oil painting from Flanders to Venice. In Venice, they said, why should we use this heavy, expensive panel? Why not use, they had the navy, they had sails, they had sailcloth, why not stretch piece of canvas on a stretcher and paint in oil, which made things more, far easier, okay? And they could, when you paint in oil, you can correct as much as you like. Right? Yes? Come on. No, what did I say? Yes, I want more questions, please. Yes?
You had one painting that had a black background. Is that unusual?
With a black background?
There was a black background. Is that unusual? Was that the painting?
Well, there's a crucifixion with a dark blue.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
And blue was very difficult in fresco because blue, if it's lapis lazuli, it's a kind of marble. So you can crush it. But you can't, it doesn't dissolve. So it doesn't enter into. So if you see Giotto, you see all the blues coming off. Yes? Yes, please.
What very first image we saw.
Sorry?
The very first image that we saw.
Yes.
Is it possible to have printouts of that?
Yes, everything is possible. I'm assuming which one is you don't
it was the chart? No, it was a wonderful historical.
Oh Lord, yes, 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 I can give it. You've been so good, you deserve more than one.
Well, thank you.
That's something I've been using for 100 years. It's a simplification of art history. It's quite interesting because it shows the dates, the schools, the importance of the artist and the influences. Okay? So you can take a little money. Something else, please. Come on. Come on. Yes?
What
kind of?
The blue colors, because in the later frescoes that I've seen, like Pontormo, the blue is actually very strong.
Oh, yes. But Pontormo, you've probably seen not a fresco, but a painting.
No, it's Santa.
Yes, the Pontormo has got the most, well, in Santa Trinita, the three Marys. And he's got a Prussian blue, a very strong blue.
Yeah.
Okay?
And in the Czech
Republic. Oh, so you're. It's Prussian blue. If you want to see the best blue, another companion is Bronzino.
Yes.
If you go to the National Gallery in London, the main room where you got the Michelangelo, the Raphael, and so on. And then there's a female room in the ivory color. And there's a blue that is so strong that the only thing you see in that room is the Bronzino.
Was that the theme?
Yes. The man here is paid.
Yes.
I wish I had time to talk about the man. He's a very good. Yes?
Was he the first to paint the wings of the angels in so many colors?
No, I wouldn't say the first, because there's an interesting painting in the National Gallery, which is heretical. And it says that there was Botticini, who explained that the devils were lost angels or something. Anyhow, and he painted these angels going ground. And the theory behind it, the dogma behind it, was considered as heretical. So it's not the best. I mean, it's like the circles of hell, which you get everywhere in the Duecento. In Italy, you've got them in Dante, you had them in the exhibition and so on. Those were quite traditional. But it's Fra Angelico who's got what's called the Danza dei Beati, the dance of the blessing. Right? And as I said, it's Dante, the more they dance, the more they move. So it's a lovely, lovely rhythm. breath such harmonies in mortal souls, while while the smother vesture of decay doth grossly close it in, we cannot hear it. That's Shakespeare who speaks about this. Yes? Oh, it's a difficult question. Yes?
When you see frescoes in museums now, which is only the very top layer, how do they do that?
Oh, nowadays it's quite easy. Don't try it at home, eh? It's what's called a strappo. Because you've got this last layer, that thing. Okay? And imagine it's a church that's going to be sort of knocked down or something, and you want to preserve a fresco. So you stick a special material to it and you pull it off. And then you stick it to wood. Right? So if you go to certain certain churches, I mean, if you go to the cathedral in Florence, and you see Paolo Cello and Castagno, and you touch it, it looks like a fresco, but then when you touch it, you realize it's on wood, which means it's been transferred. As I said, don't try it, and you only do it as a last resort, because obviously you lose a lot when you do this. But it can be done, we've done it, I've done it myself. There was an apse in a catacomb that day, which people were destroying bit by bit, so we had it removed. We built an apse, and we sort of stuck it onto something else. Yes? One last question, I think. Can we have one last question? Yes. Okay. Yes?
Could you say a bit more about his relationship or not with the Medici family?
Frangelico?
Yes.
No, Frangelico seems to have been a very quiet person. I don't think we have any account. We know a lot about Sant'Antonino with the Medici family, right? Because he was the prior. And it seems that Frangelico was such a sort of either naive or good person that when he was invited by the Pope, he said, I've got to get permission from the prior. I mean, it's not the sort of thing I would do. Okay? Anyhow, we know that Sant'Antonino really insisted with the Medici to build the priory of San Marco. He drove out the Silvestrini, which was a small congregation, and rebuilt San Marco. Right? We know a lot about the relationship between another Dominican, Savonarola, who threw them out, which threw out the Medici, okay, and set up the Consiglio del Duecento in Florence, right, the Moffitt in Florence, and put the slab on Palazzo Vecchio, Christus Rex Regum et Dominus Dominantium. Okay, he was definitely against the Medici, right, and then when he was burnt, and they put up that horrible fountain by, what's his name? I can't remember his name. Che bel marmo rovinato. Okay, that fountain just next to the Palazzo Vecchio, and there was the slab where he was burnt, and they put that fountain after his death just to make fun of his life, no? Because the Medici were back in Florence. Okay? Yes? I think that's enough?
Because the last one.
That's enough. Okay. Thank you very much. And there are no juicy bits as you're getting Caravaggio. It's far more interesting to talk about. But with Caravaggio, I managed to save one of his paintings. Here I will mention
Dr. Zerafa, grazie.